Y nosotros ahora vamos a ver un vídeo. Se trata de una explicación que da el señor Rick Strassman. Nos habla precisamente sobre DMT en la glándula pineal. Veréis que dice cosas que ya han aparecido en lo que hemos leído aquí, pero veréis cómo él, como científico, empieza a buscar todos estos detalles y va dando explicaciones. Creo que en este vídeo, si no recuerdo mal, veréis que también pueden ir apareciendo frases que no son de él, sino de la persona que ha confeccionado el vídeo, en la cual, ahora no recuerdo si es en este o en el posterior, en la cual veréis que, claro, se tira hacia la banda esotérica, ¿eh? Pero vosotros quedaos sobre todo con la parte científica de la cuestión. Vamos a...
The strange practice of mummification still holds many mysteries. Why were some organs carefully preserved while the brain was scooped out and discarded? An unexpected insight into this question can be found in the work of Dr. Rick Strassman. His pioneering work has raised some very important questions about the pineal gland and its interaction with a strange hallucinogenic chemical known as DMT. Could the interaction of these two components be the seat of consciousness? Could it in fact be the gate through which we enter and leave each new life?
I was interested in seeing if I could determine a biological basis of mystical states. That was probably how things started in the first place. And I was quite impressed with some of the commonalities that seemed to occur between spontaneously occurring mystical states, such as those that occurred with meditation and with spiritual practices, and even those described, you know, from near-death experiences. Quite a few of those descriptions seem quite comparable to descriptions of people on large doses of psychedelic drugs. And so I started to think about the possibility of some kind of compound in the brain with psychedelic properties that could be underlying some of these spontaneous experiences. I began becoming interested in the pineal gland as a possible source of some kind of psychedelic chemical in the brain. It's an extremely mysterious organ. It's quite small. There seemed to be, you know, some kind of a kind of visual correspondence with light and with color in the pineal. And also it has quite a long history in the context of the mystical literature. It's been described as the third eye and as the crown chakra, those kinds of things. And it's spoken of as being activated when people attain quite high mystical states. And so one of the interesting aspects of pineal development also is that it appears in the human embryo at around 49 days of gestation. And 49 days is also the time that the Tibetans believe is required for one soul to incarnate onto the next. So that was a pretty interesting, you know, coincidence. At the time of the differentiation of the fetus into either male or female, that also occurs at that 49-day period. And so I was struck with this interesting kind of temporal, you know, correspondence. And so as time went on, I started, you know, looking into some of the chemistry of the pineal gland. And it seemed as if it was capable of making a compound called DMT. DMT stands for dimethyltryptamine. It's like a chemical cousin of serotonin. And it's quite a profound hallucinogenic type of chemical. It seemed as if the pineal contained all of the precursors and all the enzymes and all of the building blocks that would be required to make DMT. So I started speculating about perhaps there was DMT released in the pineal gland and stimulating the brain under extraordinary, through spontaneous mystical states, the time of death or at times close to death. And also I started speculating that perhaps it was stimulated at the time of birth as well. The pineal gland is extremely well protected from stress, but you can stress the pineal gland if the stress is great enough. Pineal's protective mechanism can be overridden. And, you know, so obviously the most stressful time in a person's life is at the time of death. The stress hormones like adrenaline and endorphins are at extraordinarily high levels at the time of death. And so that could, you know, possibly stimulate the formation and the release of DMT from the pineal gland at that time. And so you can, you know, conceive of an individual's consciousness after the time of death being exposed to this big flash of DMT. And so the last thing that one is conscious of in the body is the release of this huge amount of this incredible psychedelic compound.
During his testing, Strassman discovered that abnormal levels of the chemical DMT triggered states of consciousness that closely paralleled common experiences of an afterlife.
Well, that's true. Almost everybody experienced an extremely profound, an extremely unmistakable separation of their body and their consciousness from each other.
DMT at higher levels acted as a type of catalyst for near-death experiences. In fact, it seemed to actually induce the machinery of the afterlife to swing into motion.
I suppose one of the most unexpected aspects of the study's results was the frequency with which people described a, you know, kind of contact with these intelligent, you know, kinds of entities that were, you know, conscious of them and interacted with the volunteers in this quite strange space.
A hallucinogenic state, like the dreaming state, is a temporary disconnection from the physical body. The dreamer becomes a discarnate intelligence, traversing higher realms, no longer bound to the restrictions of time and the standard laws of physics.
DMT is, you know, kind of a portal, or, you know, kind of a door for the transport of the spirit out of the body, it appears to me. In some ways, the occurrence of DMT in our brains, in our bloodstream, is you know, kind of validation of a spiritual reality in quite a few ways.
Could this strange chemical be offering us a window into events to come in the afterlife? The frequent appearance of helpers or assistants to ease us through the transition to other planes of existence suggests at least a strong parallel with funerary and afterlife traditions throughout history. The discovery of the unusual properties of the pineal gland illuminate the many strange references to this most mysterious part of the brain.
Bien, os habéis dado cuenta, supongo, de cómo al final ya se mezcla de un modo muy claro la cuestión de si sales del cuerpo con el espíritu, etcétera, etcétera. Bien, si dejamos de lado esto, por lo demás, la información es muy buena, pero hay algo, bueno, Ángel nos va a decir algo, a ver si es lo mismo.
Con respecto a esto del espíritu que comentabas, recordemos que creo que es Juan que dice: y fui llevado en espíritu a la nueva, al templo, a la nueva Jerusalén.
En el, bueno, día del Señor.
En el día del Señor. O sea que también creo que estamos hablando de una imitación clara. Fui llevado en espíritu, evidentemente, se está refiriendo a esto. Claro. A esto. O sea que esto que genera el cuerpo se ha utilizado por Dios durante la historia.
Y que Satanás, qué bien lo está haciendo, copiando y llevando a la gente a esta creencia de inmortalidad del alma, que nada tiene que ver. Hay otro detalle que me ha interesado muchísimo, y es ver que este tipo de sustancia se genera en qué día. 49 días, justo. Y 49, ¿qué número es? 7 por 7. Mirad lo importante que llega a ser esto, porque nos damos cuenta una vez más cómo Dios hace las cosas tan perfectamente con su número. Pero sabéis, más adelante deberemos hacer otra conferencia hablando de cómo el diablo también se ha encargado de coger el 7 para sus menesteres. Y vais a ver también cómo las sociedades secretas y demás lo utilizan, y porque tiene una raíz cabalística tremenda, y lo utilizan precisamente para llevar la contraria a las cosas de Dios. Pero mirad una vez más, 49. El 49 Ángel nos lo estaba diciendo. Es el ciclo para que cuando llega el de después, que es el 50, sea año de jubileo, bíblicamente. ¿Qué significa esto? Pues bien, deberemos hablar de ello dentro de poco cuando hablemos de la fecha del retorno de Cristo.